Justice Sotomayor, thank you for staying a little longer to talk with us. Your book is a very personal memoir. I know that I would have had a hard time writing something and telling these stories about my family, my parents, and my upbringing. Did you think long and hard about whether to do that?
Yeah, long time, with a lot of fears. As my preface explains in the book, I made myself very vulnerable to everybody, because I knew I'd be judged by the stories I told about the experiences I've had. And it would help some people. And I thought that that's why I finally committed to doing the book, because I realized that if my story provided an inspiration to those who face so many challenges in their own lives, then I was doing something positive. But I was also running the risk that it would be met by some with both skepticism about who I am as a person, and that that could be a great negative.
How did you decide what to tell and what not to tell?
By not making that choice, by speaking truth, by being open and being candid. Now, as someone said in reviewing the book, this is not a tell-all. I'm not and wasn't intending to look for sensationalism.
Or telling other people's stories.
Exactly. That's their lives. Those are their choices. I told my story. And, well, there was one permission I sought, and that was from my cousin Miriam and her mother Carmen, my aunt Carmen. And that was to tell Nelson's story. Because there I recognized that it wasn't my story, it was his.
And Nelson is your cousin?
He was my cousin. I say was because he died when he was 28. I was a little younger than he, but only by a few months. And I understood that it was a story that could embarrass his family. My cousin called me after reading the book, an earlier draft, where I told the story, and said to me, "First, Sonia, you brought Nelson back to life. And in telling his story in your book, you've given him a history."
And that he was addicted to drugs and he
died of AIDS. He was addicted to drugs and he died of AIDS. And Miriam's response was the one that motivated my telling the story. She said to me, "If you can help one child make a different choice, then telling the story was worth it."
You tell a story of your own childhood, growing up with kind of a withholding mother, an alcoholic father, a very loving grandmother. Did you ask your mother whether you could tell that story?
I think we had come to that decision in our life together. We've done a lot of talking through the years. This book chronicles that. And we've come to peace with the things that I felt and experienced. And so I didn't have to ask her, because she had given me permission in taking the journey with me. And she has. It's what the book describes, how we've walked my life together, she with me every step of the way.
As a lifelong diabetic, I wonder how much your chronic illness has affected the choices that you were able to make, good and bad, along the way.
The book describes it
completely.
You know, it's hard for people to live with a chronic disease, not just for diabetics, but for any child or adult who's stricken with an illness. It becomes a part of their life. It's unavoidable. It is who they are, because the disease is ever present. And one of the things I wanted to do in this book, it was first to give young diabetics hope about their own life and a real belief and understanding that they could do anything they wanted to do in life, because there are no barriers to what we can accomplish and do. However, it is something that has to be managed in your life. You just can't ignore it. You have to learn how to take care of yourself. And it's something that everyone with a chronic disease does. healthy people are those people who can recognize that disease presents you with a challenge. It challenges you to figure out how to live with it.
Couldn't you have, as maybe someone else, not you, could have decided, yes, I can't do these things because I have this disease. I am limited by it. I have choices I can't make. You said you didn't have children in part because you were worried about.
But other people made different choices about it and have children and do very well with having kids. My reasons were not just my disease, but my life choices about my career and how I wanted it to develop. But other women make very different choices. And what I want to give people is a belief, an acceptance, that it's a choice, that it's not imposed upon you.
You came up in rough and tumble world of New York City, legal community, politics. How did you remain unsullied by it, I suppose? It's hard to imagine you working in the district attorney's office and not get caught up in the maw of all of the politics that drove New York in those times.
I talk about it in the book, which was at a certain moment when I realized that if I stayed much longer in that world, I might be sullied by it. I was losing my optimism about people. And I understood that that was a product of living in a world where, in a world in which all you do is see the bad in people. That's what criminal life is, the bad, the worst in people.
Yeah.
You could forget that there are a whole lot of people who are not that way. And that's what I didn't want to lose sight about.
You are one of the most well-known, powerful, accomplished women in the world. And in the book,
thank you.
Well, you know, I think I can say that safely. And in the book, you talk about this argument we keep having with ourselves about having it all. Mm-hmm. And you pretty much think it's a silly argument.
It is a silly argument. Nobody can have it all at every single minute of their life. You're always making choices. You're always making compromises. Every single mother and father, by the way, I don't think it's just limited to women, but to a caring father faces the same choices. Which
and yet
is
the conversation is always about women.
About the choice. And,
right.
And should I be making it? Well, every day we live our life, we make a choice. We make a choice about whether we're going to be here or there at that particular time. And all we can hope for is that in the end, the fact that we care about the people in our life, that we love them, will come through, despite the fact that we can't be with the people we love every second of the day. Which mother or father who's sitting in the workplace isn't wondering what their kids are doing? And what is every mother and father doing when they're home with their family? They're thinking about all the work they've left behind. The tension is inevitable. We have to live with it. What we can make choices about is to ensure that when it really counts, we're there. And I think every parent does that.
You talk about choices. You tell a story in the book where when you were at Yale Law School, you happened to be going for some free cheese cubes after a lecture and ran into Robert Morgenthau, who recruited you to become an assistant district attorney.
I'm smiling only because it really was. I've often told him it was the free cheese that drew me into the room.
But that's not what drew you into public service, rather than private practice, where you could have had a very comfortable, very successful life as well.
Yep. And that's a choice we make, too. Every day, we make a choice about the work we're doing. And whether on a particular time in our life, we have to go and earn money to support a family, or to take care of a parent who's ill, or a family member or a friend who's ill, we make that choice every day. What kind of job can we do? And how much money do we need really to earn to survive? But those choices have to be informed choices. too many people feel like they're in handcuffs around money. And one of the things my book challenges kids to do is to think realistically, how much money do we really need to survive? My mother made less money most of her life than I've ever made, and yet we did pretty well. And so I've never thought about jobs in terms of what can pay me the most. I've thought about jobs as what job will make me happy doing it while I still survive each day.
Did I read that your mother made $6,000 a year?
For a good period of her life, yeah. That's all she made.
And raised you on your brother as
and
a doctor?
My brother. I became a lawyer and subsequently a judge and now a justice. And my brother became a doctor. And I don't think my mother earned more than about $20,000 most of her life. Hmm. I think at the end she made a little bit more.
A little bit more. You say at the end of the book or at some point that your story is not winding down, that it's only just begun. So what do you imagine? You're a justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. It's just begun?
My life now, I'm in a new phase, and I'm having a lot of fun doing my job, and I'm still enjoying it, and I hope I will continue to enjoy it for as long as I live.
Well, don't pull a Pope and decide to resign from a lifetime job.
I can assure you of the following. I won't do that for a while. How's that?
Thank you so much, Justice
Sotomayor. Thank you, Gwen,
Sotomayor.
For being with me.
Thank you.
Thanks.